So our guest today is, again, somebody who's been here before and got a great reviews. Born and raised in New York, Marty Schneit is a historian and a lecturer. He's been a featured lecturer at the New York Public Library, the JCC, the 92nd Street Y, to name a few. He's also had his programs recorded for the Jewish Braille Institute, and we're really, really pleased to have him here with us today to talk, to take us to, since we can't get out, since we're quarantined still, and we can't get into the city. I think probably many of us have not been in the city in quite some time. I know I haven't. It'll be nice to get back to our old New York. Many of us, I think there's Marty might touch on this. I think there's just a statistic across the country. There's like everybody has somebody that was born, like they can trace their roots back to Brooklyn somehow. So I know that we can trace our relatives back to Brooklyn. So I'm going to let Marty take it away, and I am going to leave my spotlight here. Stop, remove spotlight. There's Marty. Take it away, Marty.
Okay, so I want to thank Michelle for inviting me back. So now we're going to make the transition to share the screen, and we'll go to the slide presentation. Okay. A while ago, I attended a lecture given by Paul Goldberger. Paul Goldberger was an architectural critic, and someone in the audience asked him what he thought the greatest architectural icon in New York is, and he said, the Brooklyn Bridge. So you're looking at a wonderful illustration here done by a French artist, Francois Rocca. It's an illustration of people watching the construction of the Brooklyn Bridge, knowing that it'll be the first time they would be able to walk over a river with the sky as a roof. It'll be higher than they'd ever been before. There were no airplanes when the Brooklyn Bridge was completed, no skyscrapers when the bridge was completed in 1883. The tallest building in New York then was Trinity Church in Walnut Broad. People here observing the old world medieval Gothic stone towers and a new world wire rope, watching the bridge being designed by an immigrant and built by immigrants. So this is probably how Manhattan Island looked when the Indians were here. They named the island Manhattan, the island of many hills. We can now call it the island of many Starbucks. They say that if Manhattan Island had not been developed the way it is today, it would be the most beautiful national park in America. So the Indians were very smart, because there was no land transportation back then. The only way they could get around was by canoe and footpath. A very famous footpath is what we call Broadway today. So what the Indians would do, they would get in their canoes here in the lower part of Manhattan, and it would cross what we call the Hudson River today, and it would make deals with the Hackensack Indians. Another day, they would get in their canoes and cross what we call the East River today and make deals with the Canarsie Indians. So the Indians were making deals, and that's exactly what's going on today. People coming in from New Jersey and other parts of the city and making deals. So we can say that the Indians set the template who what New York became. It was a combination of the Indians setting the template, the marketing ingenuity of the Dutch, and the Brooklyn Bridge. And New York became the commercial center of America. So here's how New York looked in the 1850s before the bridge. In 1642, the first ferry, actually it was a rowboat, crossed the East River to Brooklyn. It took 1 hour. As a result of that event, Brooklyn became the first suburb in America. And then in 1814, Robert Fulton invented the steam ferry. Now the steam ferry can cross the East River to Brooklyn in 10 minutes. As a result of that event, Brooklyn became the first commuter suburb in America. A commutation ticket for a single person for 12 months back then, $10 a year. I would like to read a quote about the commuter from E.B. White. E.B. White was a great American writer. And here's what E.B. White said about the commuter. The commuter is one who spends his life in riding to and from his wife. A man who shaves and takes a train and then rides back to shave again. The ping-ponging between home and work was their sacrifice to the American dream, the proverbial backyard and picket fence were a daily affront to the reality that they could not afford to raise a family in Manhattan, or for some of them, both. So what happened, the East River would freeze up in the winter, and it created what was called an ice bridge. So back then, for people to get to New York, to Brooklyn, they would cross on this ice bridge. And it was this gentleman, John Roebling, a German-born American civil engineer. He was on a ferry one day and it got stuck in ice. And this set off the spark that ignited Roebling's desire for a bridge to be built to Brooklyn. He had designed and built wire rope suspension bridges in the past. So he was appointed the chief engineer in the construction of the Brooklyn Bridge. One day, while he was standing at the edge of a dock, his foot was crushed by an arriving ferry. He developed tetanus and he died. So his son, Washington Roebling, an American civil engineer, took over the construction of the Brooklyn Bridge. The Brooklyn Bridge opened in 1883. When it opened, it was the longest suspension bridge in the world. The roadway of the bridge would be high enough so the bridge would not interfere with traffic on the river. It was considered the eighth wonder of the world. The two stone towers that you see supported the four cables that support the roadway. Material was brought to the work site in a horse and buggy. The vertical wires that you see here would connect the roadbed to the four cables. Here we have the roadbed and the four cables and the vertical wires. Granite blocks were brought to the work site with a horse and wagon for the construction of the two towers. Now they use structural steel for the towers. Next time you go over the George Washington Bridge, you'll see those towers were made of structural steel. Structural steel was first used in 1890. The Brooklyn Bridge was completed in 1883. The bridge was really built to get to Brooklyn. Manhattan was filled up with vertical growth. Brooklyn could expand out to Long Island, also known as horizontal growth, which you cannot have, of course, in Manhattan. The Brooklyn people did not want the bridge. They said all these bad people from New York are going to come in here now, and there goes the neighborhood. The first work of construction entailed the construction of caissons upon which the two towers would be built. The caissons were large wooden boxes. Each one was about the size of a tennis court. It had no bottom. And they were placed in the river. Here's an illustration. Here's the caisson right here. And there are the sand hogs, and they're building the tower above the caisson. So compressed air was pumped into the caisson to keep the river water out. The sand hogs made $2 a day, and they had to chip away at the boulders and remove sand and loose stones. The caisson would settle at the rate of 3 to 4 inches in 24 hours. It would take about 2 years for the caisson to reach solid rock, and then the caisson would be filled with concrete. And here you see wagons moving mud and rocks to a barge. So again, the caisson would drop gradually. As it was dropping, the towers were being built above it, and when the caisson hit solid rock, they would complete the construction of the caisson. So a number of workers, sand hogs, developed a decompression disease or bends. One of the reasons, the main reason they would develop that is they would come out too quickly from the caisson. And here are sand hogs removing sand, loose stones, and chipping away at the boulders. Washington Roebling had a hands-on approach in the construction of the bridge. And he would go down to the caisson and help the sand hogs, but he developed the bends. As a result, he became totally paralyzed and he was not able to assist in the construction of the Brooklyn Bridge. So his wife, Emily Roebling, took over the construction of the Brooklyn Bridge. She wasn't an engineer. She read engineering books. The general consensus then was that women's brains were not capable of comprehending such complex ideas. Washington Roebling would get together with Emily Roebling every evening. She would take notes and show the workers what to do the following morning. Most of the immigrants could not even read or speak English. An important part of the Brooklyn Bridge was the walking promenade, which had never been a part of a bridge before. The promenade is 18 feet above the traffic. The next time you go over the George Washington Bridge, there's a small walkway, but it's at the same level of the vehicular traffic. Here's a quote from David McCulloch, who wrote The Great Bridge. To be able to walk out on that bridge was a thrill that we have to use our imagination to appreciate. The Brooklyn Bridge, to this day, working on the Brooklyn Bridge is one of the two top tourist attractions in the city of New York. The two top attractions are getting a pastrami sandwich at Cass's Delicatessen and walking over the Brooklyn Bridge. The Brooklyn Bridge can get quite crowded on the weekend with tourists. Here's how it looked. This is before the coronavirus, of course, and there was no social distancing back then. But we're going to see this again. This is going to come back. And when this comes back, we can tell the whole world that New York is back, New York, the greatest city in the world. And this was Frank Harrington, the master mechanic, who was the first to cross the East River on wire rope. Opening day, Emily Roebling was driven across the bridge in a horse-drawn carriage. The workers raised their hats and saluted her. She met President Chester Arthur in the middle of the bridge. She had a white rooster in her lap. The white rooster was a symbol of victory. The mayors of New York and Brooklyn were present on opening day. About 150,000 people were present opening day. Now, it wasn't Roebling's bridge anymore, it was the People's Bridge. There was an elderly lady who witnessed the walking over the Brooklyn Bridge opening day and also saw the astronauts walking on the moon in 1969. They asked her what she thought was a better experience, and she said walking on the Brooklyn Bridge. There was a sign in a Brooklyn shop window in 1883 when the bridge opened. Babylon has her hanging gardens, Egypt her pyramids, Athens her Acropolis, Rome her Pantheon, so Brooklyn has the Brooklyn Bridge. So when the Brooklyn Bridge opened in 1883, it connected the two great cities of New York and Brooklyn. And then in 1898, when the five boroughs were consolidated to form the Greater New York, New York was renamed Manhattan. About a week after the bridge opened, a woman had tripped and fell down the stairs. Another woman screamed, "The bridge is collapsing, the bridge is collapsing." So this sound that sent the crowd into hysteria, and 10 people died. And now they were afraid to walk over the bridge. So this great showman, P.T. Barnum, and there was a film recently about him, The Great Showman. I happened to see it. I thought it was a wonderful film. If you haven't seen it, I would suggest you see it. Well, P.T. Barnum had his museum right by the Brooklyn Bridge. And what he did, he took one of his elephants, Jumbo. He had Jumbo lead 20 elephants across the Brooklyn Bridge to show the public that it was safe to walk over the Brooklyn Bridge. P.T. Barnum was very fortunate that he didn't have to deal with the animal rights activists back then. So, you know, there are a lot of expressions about the Brooklyn Bridge. Let's say you're with a group of people and you're talking about a certain topic. And someone in the group has mentioned something that's not related to what you were talking about. You might say, well, what does that have to do with the Brooklyn Bridge? I'm sure you've heard that expression. Well, let's say you're in a store and you're dealing with a salesperson. And you say to your friend, gee, this guy, he could probably sell you the Brooklyn Bridge. Well, back actually in 1899, Francis O'Day paid $200 to purchase the Brooklyn Bridge. He got a bill of sale. It read, one bridge in good condition. Can you imagine that? He goes home to his wife that day. He's got the bill of sale in his hand. And he says, Harriet, I've got great news. I just purchased the Brooklyn Bridge. And Harriet said, well, that's wonderful, but you know, you're not handy. So whenever it breaks down, you're gonna have to call in people to fix it. So he says, Harriet, don't worry. We'll cross that bridge when we get there. This gentleman, Steve Brody, he bet people that he was gonna jump off the Brooklyn Bridge and survive. So one day he's in the East River and the owner of a tugboat found him and he said, I just jumped off the Brooklyn Bridge. But no one saw him jump off the Brooklyn Bridge, but a lot of people believed him. So this event resulted in a play on the Bowery. The play was a big hit and Brody became very famous and rich. Brooklyn Bridge is used for advertisements, paintings. And the Brooklyn Bridge is used in films. Here we have Woody Allen, Diane Keaton in the film, Annie Hall. And this film, 1949 film, On the Town, with Gene Kelly, Frank Sinatra, and Jules Munster. We get some great views from the Brooklyn Bridge. This building here, 8 Spruce Street. The name of the architect, Frank Gehry. Gehry is considered one of the most famous contemporary architects today. The facade of that building has 10,000 stainless steel panels, ripples running up and down the facade. And this building here, certainly one of my favorite buildings, the Woolworth Building, built by Frank Woolworth, the nickel and dime empire. Terracotta facade, terracotta mimic stone. There's a statue of Frank Woolworth in the lobby counting his nickels and dimes. Frank Woolworth is interred in a mausoleum at Woodland Cemetery. I happen to see it. It's the most elaborate mausoleum in the cemetery. It has sphinx on each side of it. Frank Woolworth said, if it's good enough for a pharaoh, it's good enough for me. The top 30 floors of the Woolworth Building are condominiums, and right here, there's a 7-story penthouse up for sale. I have a close-up for you. There it is, 7-story penthouse. Private elevator, swimming pool. Now, it went on the market in 2017 for $110 million. It's just been reduced to $80 million. So if any of you are interested in purchasing this penthouse, see me at the end of my lecture or speak to me at the end of the lecture. I befriended the developer. I may be able to get you a good deal. I might get it down at maybe $70 million for you. So when I walk on the Brooklyn Bridge, I go very, very early in the morning. And occasionally I see a scene like this. And when I see a scene like this, I can only think of the great American icon, Frank Sinatra.
Start spreading the news. I'm leaving today. I want to be part of it. New York, New York. These vagabond shoes are longing to stray.
So here are some statistics of the Brooklyn Bridge. It opened in 1883, cost a total of $15 million to build. Took 14 years to build. The two stone towers, 7 years to build. The river span is 1,600 feet from tower to tower. The towers rise 272 feet above the water. 27 men lost their lives. The bridge would survive the radical transition from horse and buggy to automobile traffic. Today, a combined force of about 30 men look after the bridge. It gets a new coat of paint every 5 years. So here we have the Jane Carousel, right by the Brooklyn Tower. A fire broke out in 1922 at an Ohio theme park. 40 wooden horses were destroyed. In 1984, Jane Walensky paid $385,000 for the four horses, and it took her 20 years to restore the horses. And we have this great carousel. She gave the carousel as a gift to Brooklyn, to the Brooklyn waterfront neighborhood. And she spent $9 million to build this acrylic pavilion. And what Jane did, she scraped layers of paint to find the original design. A great story. And one of the things that makes New York one of the greatest cities in the world, we call this reuse. You know, there was an abandoned railway in the West Side, and they were going to tear it down. But they got people that donated a lot of money, philanthropic people, and they created the High Line Park, today a great public park. So that's one of the great things that makes New York such a great city. We call this reuse. And we have the New York Public Library built with private money. And what about Andrew Carnegie? Andrew Carnegie donated $5 million to build 65 branch libraries of the New York Public Library. This is Dumbo, down under the Manhattan Bridge overpass between the Brooklyn and Manhattan bridges. This building here in 1914 was built as a cardboard factory, and then it closed down. And Jane's husband, who owns a lot of property in the Dumbo, purchased the building and converted it into a high-priced condominium. And here we have a clock tower, a penthouse, it's called. I have a close-up for you. There it is. It's called the Clock Tower Penthouse. In 2017, it sold for $15 million. The ceilings are 50 feet high. So in 1909, Jehovah's Witnesses opened up their headquarters here, and they bought 40 properties in Brooklyn Heights and Dumbo when the market was dead. This was luck or divine intervention. They relocated to Rock Hill, New York. They sold all the properties. They made over $1 billion. So with the invention of the steam ferry in 1814, Brooklyn became a major manufacturing center. By 1850, the piers had warehouses and piers along the Brooklyn waterfront that you see here. When the Manhattan and Brooklyn bridges were completed, now trucks and container shipping in New Jersey caused the demise of the waterfront. 130 warehouses were demolished along the waterfront. From this, we get Brooklyn Bridge Park, another great example of reuse. The money from the residential development covers the operating costs of the park. And this image shows you about the ethnic diversity of the city. Here we have the Statue of Liberty, a gift from France celebrating a 100th anniversary of independence. We had a great relationship with the French back then. At the base of the Statue of Liberty, you have a sonnet written by Emma Lazarus, a Sephardic Jew, give me your tithe, your poor, your huddled masses. And then we get the Brooklyn Bridge, designed by an immigrant, built by Irish and Italian immigrants. Brooklyn Heights. At first, it was the first suburb in America. And then as a result of the steamboat, it became the first commuter suburb in America. So Brooklyn Heights has some of the greatest examples of brownstones in the city of New York. And they were built in the 1840s. When they were opened up, of course, they were single family owned, And a brownstone is actually built of brick. So there's brick. The brick would be in a facade originally when it was built. And then some people covered it up with brownstone. Brownstone was placed over the brick. Brownstone came from a quarry in Portland, Connecticut. The brownstone would come down the Connecticut River to New York. So here you have the basement here with a separate entrance. The servants would go in this entrance and the kitchen was in here. This was the parlor. The parlor was the most important room in the brownstone. That's where they would have wedding ceremonies and funerals and old funeral homes back then. Now the owners of the brownstone wanted the parlor elevated. So that way, when they looked out of their windows, they can see over the bodies of the horses. So since the parlor was elevated, they wanted their separate entrance to get into the parlor. They didn't want to go through this entrance. So the separate entrance is here. To get to that entrance, they had to build a stoop. And then the owners of the brownstone and their family lived on this floor. The servants lived on this floor right here. 124 Willow Street, the owners of Lipton Tea Company owned this building, but you can see here, they didn't cover up the brick with brownstone. They left the brick exposed. For some reason, though, they used brownstone here at the entrance. Now, in the early days, all these people that lived here had horses, and this was a carriage house. They would store the hay up here, and of course, the horses in there. And these carriage houses in Brooklyn Heights have been converted into apartments. 70 Willow Street in Brooklyn Heights. This is where Oliver Smith, a stage designer who designed West Side Story and The Sound of Music. Truman Capote rented the basement apartment in this house. It was in this, here's a quote from Truman Capote from his essay, Brooklyn Heights, a Personal Memoir. I live in Brooklyn by choice. It was in this basement that Truman Capote wrote the novel In Cold Blood, which earned him millions of dollars. Capote decided to throw an extraordinary masked ball to celebrate the success of the book at the Plaza Hotel in 1966. The invitees were told to wear just two colors, black and white. Everyone wanted the invitation. Capote invited 500 friends, but he made 15,000 enemies. Those who weren't invited, they would go out of town the night of the party. If they didn't go out of town, they would stay home with their lights off. Some of the people invited to this party were Frank Sinatra, Mia Farrow, Norman Miller, the Kennedys, Rockefellers, Vanderbilts, Whitneys. It was the party of the century at the Plaza Hotel. It was the largest party they ever had. And here's Truman Capote. He boasted that he paid 39 cents at F.A.O. Schwartz for his black Halloween mask. This is a great example of Queen Anne architecture. The architecture I showed you before was classical. Classical has a sense of balance. In Queen Anne architecture, we get a harmony of textures. We get stone, we have brick, we have the bay window. So it's a mixture of textures. You don't have that sense of balance here like you would have in classical architecture. This house is known as the Moonstruck House. It was built in 1829 at Cranberry and Willow Streets. This house was used in 1987 in the movie Moonstruck with Cher and Nicolas Cage. In 2008, it sold for $4 million. Another example of where they didn't use the brownstone to cover the brick. Plymouth Church on Orange Street in Brooklyn Heights. At the center of the garden, is Henry Ward Beecher, the first pastor of Plymouth Church. Beecher was an abolitionist. His sister was Harriet Beecher Stowe, who wrote Uncle Tom's Cabin. To the left here is a bas relief of Lincoln. The sculptor here was Borg Lund. He also created Mount Rushmore. Under Beecher, the church had connections with the Underground Railroad, which helped slaves escape to Canada. slaves were hidden in the basement of the church. Beecher would hold mock slave auctions, and Beecher would bring slaves into the sanctuary and auction them off to the highest bidder and then set them free. This young girl here, her name was Pinky. She was a 9-year-old girl, slave girl. Her father was the owner. Her father needed money. So he decided to set her free. He took her up to Plymouth Church from Alabama on February 5th, 1860, in front of a crowd of 3,000 people. Mr. Beecher started the bidding. A collection plate was passed around. When the plate reached the pulpit, there was $900 and a ring on the plate. Beecher picked up the ring and placed it on the finger of Pinky, and he said, "With this ring, I do wed thee to freedom." Pinky eventually moved to Washington, D.C. She became a teacher. And then in 1927, when she was 76 years old, she brought the ring back to Plymouth Church, where it is today in a display case. Here's Beecher holding a mock slave auction. The reason why they called it mock is because Beecher was not a professional auctioneer. On October 1859, Plymouth Church offered Abraham Lincoln $200 to come to Brooklyn to give a lecture to the congregants of Plymouth Church. Lincoln accepted the invitation, and here's a copy of the invitation, and Lincoln participated in a church service on Sunday, February 26, 1859. Because of high demand, Lincoln was moved to Cooper Union, where a 25-cent admission fee was charged. Before he gave the speech to Cooper Union that morning, Abe Lincoln went to Matthew Brady's portrait studio. Matthew Brady was a very prominent Civil War photographer. And Matthew Brady took a picture, this picture of Lincoln. What he did here, he pulled his cuffs down, and Lincoln had a long neck. So he covered part of his neck with a shirt collar. He put his hand on a book to give Lincoln a more scholarly book. And that evening, he gave a speech at Cooper Union in front of a crowd of 1,500 people. The title of the speech was "Let's Have Faith, Might Makes Right." 50,000 copies of the speech were distributed across the country. Here's a quote from Lincoln. "Brady and the Cooper Union speech made me president." Here's the Brooklyn Queens Expressway, built by Robert Moses. I had a bad experience with Robert Moses. I grew up in East Tremont section of the Bronx, and the same Robert Moses, who was the park commissioner, built the Cross Bronx Expressway, displaced about 20,000 families. And the entire Bronx went down as a result of that. It was a disaster. And to this day, the Cross Bronx Expressway is one of the worst expressways in America. People travel 20, 30 miles out of their way to avoid it. He wanted to do the same thing in Brooklyn Heights. He wanted to build an expressway through Brooklyn into Queens, just like he did in the Bronx, but the people won't let him do it. So he had to settle for the BQA, or Brooklyn to Queens Expressway. The residents wanted a promenade. He was against the promenade. Robert Moses was all about the automobile. He really didn't care about walking. He wanted to eliminate or take apart the walking promenade of the Brooklyn Bridge. Now the BQA, it's falling apart. It has to be totally rebuilt. So what the city wants to do, they want to convert the promenade into vehicular traffic while they're rebuilding the Brooklyn Queens Expressway. But the residents don't want that. They say that the promenade will have to be closed for 6 years if they do that. So right now they're working on a solution, which is the best way to rebuild the BQA. And here's the promenade. So here we have, here's Brooklyn Heights right here. And this is Greenwood Cemetery. It was at Greenwood Cemetery where the first great battle of the American Revolution occurred on August 27, 1776. The British defeated George Washington and his troops gained control of the port of New York. And every year they celebrate this event at Greenwood Cemetery. It's held on a Sunday in August, closest to that date. And I've been to it. It's a very emotional and touching event. If you haven't been to it, I would suggest you put it on your calendar. If you decide to go, you're going to get to Greenwood Cemetery. And when you go there, you're going to go to the top of the hill. It's called Battle Hill. That's where the first great battle of the American Revolution occurred. And when you get to Battle Hill, you're going to see a large statue of a goddess. That goddess is Minerva, the goddess of wisdom. And what I want you to do when you get there, I want you to stand directly behind Minerva, and I want you to look straight ahead. And you're going to see Lady Liberty looking right at Minerva. Lady Liberty looking at the site where the first great battle of the American Revolution occurred. Lady Liberty looking at America's struggle for liberty. Not too long ago, a developer wanted to put up a high-rise condominium between the two great ladies. And a community activist said, you can't do that. You can't block that great historical view between the two ladies. They took the developer to court, and the judge ruled in favor of the community. So Washington evacuated his entire army from Battle Hill. And he wanted to cross the East River into Manhattan, eventually go into New Jersey. Washington had no navy. At this time, the British had about 300 ships of the British Navy over here, and they were heading to Brooklyn Heights, because Brooklyn Heights was the highest point in all of Greater New York. He who carries the heights carries the city. It just so happens a storm was blowing down the East River, which prevented the British ships from sailing up. And a fog broke out. So Washington and his army retreated into Brooklyn Heights, across the East River, up Manhattan, and they were across the Hudson River at the present site of the George Washington Bridge. Here were rowboats crossing the East River. The sailors tied their shirts around their oars to muffle the sound. George Washington was the last one to cross the river. All of George Washington's troops had been evacuated with no loss of life. 13 years later, after this event, George Washington was inaugurated as President of the United States. Here we have Montague Street in Brooklyn, a great street. I love Montague Street. They have just about every kind of restaurant there. And here we have the Bossett Hotel. It one time was owned by the Jehovah's Witnesses. Now it's privately owned. It's an upscale hotel. But in 1955, the Brooklyn Dodgers celebrated their first World Series victory in the ballroom of the Bossett Hotel. And it was at this site, Montague and Cadman Plaza in Brooklyn Heights, where in 1945, Jackie Robinson signed a contract to play for the Brooklyn Dodgers. And here's Ebbets Field, opened in 1913, closed in 1957. Ebbets Field, named after Charlie Ebbets. Charlie Ebbets was an office boy for the Brooklyn Dodgers and became the owner. What a great story. Today's stadiums and arenas, most of them have corporate names. But you know, I was raised and lived in the Bronx, and of course I was an avid Yankee fan, but occasionally I would go to Ebbets Field. And to this day, I regret that I didn't go to more games at Ebbets Field. They were great fans. They had the best fans. Ebbets Field was personal. I call it the meat and potato crowd. It was a place where you could fall in love with the game. The Yankees were always corporate. And of course, for the fans to get to Ebbets Field, they had to go, there were trolleys constantly moving by. So to get to the field, they had to dodge the trolleys. That's how we get the name Dodgers. So I have to mention a great American icon in this lecture, Neil Diamond. Neil Diamond attended Erasmus Hall High School in Brooklyn. At one time, Barbara Streisand was in the same class as Neil Diamond. Can you imagine that? Barbara Streisand and Neil Diamond being in the same class. So in Fenway Park in Brooklyn, at every home game, at the bottom of the seventh inning, they play Neil Diamond's Sweet Caroline. So what I'd like to do now with you, I'd like to bring us back in time. We're all going to pretend we're at Ebbets Field. It's the bottom of the seventh inning. The Dodgers are ahead 3-2. Neil Diamond singing Sweet Caroline. Okay, all right. All right, any comments or questions?
I thought that was terrific. Thank you.
Oh, thank you. Hopefully, hopefully when this pandemic passes over, we can all meet and walk over the Brooklyn Bridge.
That would be very nice.
Yeah, I mean,
that
it,
would
really.
Be very. I yeah. used to walk over the bridge with my husband. It was wonderful looking out. Yeah. It was fabulous.
Yeah, it's a great walk. And like I showed you, it's a big tourist attraction now.
Yeah, and the street before the bridge as you go over was very interesting.
Yeah, there are people walking over the bridge today, but you know, it might be difficult with social distancing and all that. You don't know, some people are not going to wear a mask. So it's better to wait until this thing passes over to walk over it again.
I agree with you.
Yeah. And then you'd have to ride the subway maybe to get down there. You don't want that either, you know.
Yeah. I didn't realize that Neil Diamond, Barbara Streisand went to Erasmus Hall High School.
Yeah. You know, a couple of people who attended that high school told me that. You know, yeah, isn't that something? Can you imagine?
Yes, that is something.
That's incredible. Two icons.
They both lived in Brooklyn, obviously.
Yeah.
That was just interesting.
Anyone else?
I went to Ebbets Field a couple times.
Yeah.
And I remember going into Fitzsimmons across the street to have a drink. And he didn't play for the Dodgers. I think he played for the Giants.
I'm not sure.
Freddie Fitzsimmons.
Great field, though.
Yeah.
As I mentioned in my lecture, I regret that I didn't go there more often. They were great fans. Like I said, the Yankees were always corporate, you know, and you didn't get the same feel at Yankee Stadium like you did in Ebbets Field. And those fans in Brooklyn, boy, they really knew their baseball. They're mostly the blue-collar workers, you know. And they were great, yeah. And they had some great players back then, too. Duke Snyder, Ferrillo, and Campanella. Yeah.
Roy Campanella.
Yeah, wow. Yeah.
Martin, I grew up in Brooklyn Heights on Willow Place.
You used to live there?
Yes, I grew up there. And I still have family there on Willow Place.
Oh, great, yeah.
I was at that 1955 event. At the Mossberg when the Dodgers won the World Series.
Oh, yeah, sure, yeah.
I was a teenager.
Were you at their celebration at the Boston Hotel?
Yes, that's where, yes, I was there.
You were there, wow.
Not inside, outside.
Oh, you were outside. You couldn't go. There must have been a lot of people outside, right?
Oh, it was, yes, because, you know, I mean, it was an event, and we also celebrated. Oh, yeah. At City Hall on the steps of City Hall.
Do you have any pictures of that day when you were there with the crowd?
No, that was a teenager.
If you had a picture, I'd ask you to send it to me. Yeah.
My sisters may have something because my mother had a lot of pictures.
If you can locate one, you have my email. I really greatly appreciate it. You can forward it to me.
I'll check it out. Yeah, I'll check it out.
Yeah, we'll probably add it to my lecture. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's great.
She's my mother was a Sweet Caroline, and they have a plaque for her on a tree on Columbia Place in Brooklyn Heights.
What do they do? All right.
She was kind of like the matriarch.
yeah, all right. The matriarch of Brooklyn Heights.
Yeah, and hold on. I don't know if you can see this.
Wait, Jackie, let me spotlight you.
Oh, yeah, I see it. Yeah, sure.
My grandmother and grandfather sitting in the Erie on Willow Place.
Right. Okay, I see it. Yeah, well, wonderful. Yeah, thank you.
Wonderful memories.
So if you can ever locate a picture of that Boston Hotel, you know, that would be great.
Yeah, I'll get your email from Michelle, and if I can find one, I'll let you know.
Sure. Okay, great. Okay. Anyone else?
Talking about Neil Diamond, the song Sweet Caroline, I heard that he wrote that song for Caroline Kennedy. Is that true?
That's the rumor, but it's not 100% accurate. No. There's a rumor about that, but it's not 100% accurate. No. Yeah, I did some research on it, and it's not a done deal. I mean,
I think he
denied it. He was a big admirer of Caroline Kennedy. Yeah, he loved the Kennedy family. Mm-hmm. But that's not 100% correct, though. But it's a great song, regardless. Just a great song. And they do play it every home seventh inning in Ebbets Field. In fact, when they had the that bomber, the Boston Marathon, a number of years ago, Neil Diamond went up to Ebbets Field, to Fenway Park in person and sang Sweet Caroline. They were going crazy. Yeah.
This is Doris. I grew up three blocks from Ebbets Field, and the apartment building that I lived in was apparently a hotel for Brooklyn Dodger players and their relatives before it became an apartment building.
All right. Okay, thank you. Now, of course, Ebbets Field has a housing project there now, and then, in fact, one of the biggest disasters in New York is when the Dodgers left New York. Robert Moses was one of the culprits with that also. O'Malley wanted it. What happened is Ebbets Field can only seat about 35,000 people. At that time, Yankee Stadium could seat 75,000 people, and so could the Polo Grounds. So they wanted a stadium with a larger attendance so they could get more revenue. That made sense. So O'Malley wanted to move to another part of Brooklyn, but Moses wanted him to go to Queens. He said, well, I don't want Queens. He wanted to move to the section now where the New York, Jersey, the Nets play, Barclay Center. So he worked out a deal in California, yeah. And to this day, there are diehard Brooklyn Dodger fans that are still upset about that. It was awful. And they tore it down, and now you have a housing project on its site.
Yeah, a lot of famous people from Brooklyn. Doris also said that Barbara Streisand was a year ahead of her in class, and Bobby Fischer was in one of her classes. That was the Doris who just
Bobby
spoke.
That was a very famous high school. A lot of well-known people came out of that high school.
Was that the Bobby Fischer, the chess player?
Yes.
Is that the chess player? Is that right? Yeah.
Wow.
I met some alumni from that high school in my lectures.
It says online that Neil Diamond loved the Kennedys, but he was writing the song, trying to write it for his wife, but he needed a three-syllable name, and his wife's name was Marcia, and it didn't work.
Oh.
That's what it just said when I looked it up.
Okay, that's fair enough.
Mm-hmm. And sweet Marcia.
I think Caroline sounds better than Marcia, though. I've been to several of his concerts. He gives a great concert, Neil Diamond. Neil Diamond attracted all ages too in his concert, it's wonderful. Best concerts I've been to.
And he still does.
Well, he's in bad shape now, right? Doesn't he have, does he have Alzheimer's?
Parkinson's, I think maybe.
Parkinson's, you're right, Parkinson's, yeah.
Marty, what's up on the horizon for us?
Well, I have to look at my schedule. I'm on my computer now, but I don't want to go to that part of the computer.
I'm just wondering what else, what other neighborhoods we're going to do.
You're coming up October 29th, West Side Stories, the Upper West Side.
Oh, great. Okay.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, that's the Upper West Side.
Okay.
That's October 29th, Thursday.
Right, that's then, next Thursday.
November 5th, Thursday, the Lower East Side, Okay, that's it.
Yep.
So and then November 12th, the Bronx.
The Bronx. Looking right. Forward to hearing the Bronx.
Oh, yeah. You lived in the Bronx?
I went to college in the Bronx and day camp in the Bronx, even though I lived in Upper Manhattan on the upper West Side.
Where did you go to Fordham University?
I went to Fordham. Yeah.
Yeah. You know, the high school, there's a high school across the street from Fordham University. That's the high school I went to, Theodore Roosevelt High School.
Theodore Roosevelt, yes.
Yeah. It closed down a number of years ago because the only about 2%, the graduation rate was about 2%. Only about 2% of the students graduated.
Yeah. And also, if you remember, on University Avenue was the original campus for NYU. And when I went to Fordham, NYU was in the Bronx. There was a small campus in Manhattan.
Today it's the Bronx Community College.
Bronx Community College, yes.
And that's where they had the Hall of Fame for great Americans at that college. At that campus.
The original Hall of Fame, yes.
Yeah, it's still there.
Yes.
Yeah. That's interesting.
And you know, the architecture at what's now Bronx Community College, it's phenomenal. Great architecture.
It's up on a hill.
Oh, yeah.
It's beautiful.
Yeah. Sanford White, I think, is one of the main architects there, a very well-known architect, yeah.
Yes.
The library is a beautiful classical building.
Absolutely. Yeah. It's a great campus.
Yeah, it's a great campus. You're right, yeah.
What about Queens?
Queens.
Can't forget Queens.
I'll tell you about Queens. When I lived in the Bronx, we went to Flushing a lot, and they had a great Chinese restaurant there. I forget the name. We used to go to Flushing for that Chinese food.
Well,
and then of course you had the World's Fair there.
Absolutely.
Marty, there's a question coming in. What was the brown stone? How thick was it, and how was it attached?
Well, I guess they used some kind of mortar to attach the brown stone to the brick. How thick it was, I can only give you an approximation. I would say probably 2 or 3 inches. But you can see they're called row houses. That's what they call row houses, and we get that concept of row houses from the Dutch, because New York was a Dutch colonial city at one time. And like I showed you in the lecture, some were exposed, the brick was exposed, and in some instances they covered the brick with the brownstone. Brownstone is very popular today. A lot of young people that are buying brownstones, they prefer the brownstone rather than the brick. They feel that the brownstone has more of the old world look to it than the brick. But brownstone is very difficult to maintain because of the weathering conditions, rain, snow, whatever. So the brownstones in Brooklyn Heights are in excellent condition because they've been maintained so well over the years. Also, you have some excellent brownstones in certain parts of Harlem today.
Absolutely. Convent Avenue, right by City College.
Yeah, City College, yeah, mm-hmm. yeah.
Yep.
Hamilton Heights is over there. Yeah,
you got some great. That's my old neighborhood. There. Right across the street from City College, yes. Yes. And, of course, the New York Giants baseball team, you mentioned how broken the city was when the Dodgers left to Los Angeles, but a story that isn't told is how so many people suffered when the Giants moved to San Francisco.
Yeah,
that was a big loss.
Yeah, it was. And they had Willie Mays. Oh, gee.
Willie Mays.
Imagine how, I consider myself so lucky. When I was a kid, there were 3 baseball teams, the Giants, the Yankees, and the Dodgers.
Yes.
And, yeah.
So, Marty, I travel around the area when the weather is nice and take pictures. So in September, I went to Brooklyn, and I went to Coney Island, and by myself, I walked on the boardwalk. I took a bazillion pictures. I went to Sheepshead Bay, where I had gone to school and never saw the bay. So I saw the Sheepshead Bay for the first time, took pictures of that. Then I went to Grand Army Plaza and took pictures of that. And
you need any of those pictures, I have tons of them.
Correct. Those probably not, but that's great. I mean, you can send me, I'd love to see it, but why don't you send me three of them? I'd like to take a look at it, actually.
Grand Army Plaza is amazing. People forget it looks like the Arc de Triomphe.
Yes. Yeah.
The Grand Army Plaza, yeah. Now, when I was a kid, I lived in the Bronx, and my parents did not own a car. A very popular trip was to take the subway to Coney Island, and we went on Steeplechase. Remember Steeplechase, those rides?
I have it right in front of me.
We would always go to Nathan's and get the hot dog, and I still love Nathan's to this day. the Nathan's in Coney Island seems to be better than the other Nathan's that they have, the other franchises.
Yeah. There's Steeplechase.
Oh, yeah.
Can you see it?
Oh, wait. Are you
that
showing?
I don't think that was the Steeplechase. That was the parachute.
Oh, that's the parachute. What was the
Steeplechase? That's the parachute. The Steeplechase was the horses.
With Steeplechase, I rode those horses.
Oh, the horses.
They run right around a building.
Yeah. The parachute was outside of Steeplechase.
Yes.
Now,
the loop-de-loo or whatever it was called.
The Mets have a farm team there.
Look at that.
It's a great place to go. You can see the parachute from the stadium.
Yes.
That's great.
So Steeplechase was that guy with the Alfred E. Newman face.
I think
that was on the outside of the building. Yeah, but they were horses. Right. I think there were 6 or 7 or 8 horses, wooden horses on a track.
Yeah, I rode the horses. Yeah, that was my favorite ride.
Yeah, absolutely.
Guy.
Yeah, yeah.
I was saying, Asbury Park had that.
They have that same
guys.
Image.
I have another meeting, so that was fun, Marty. Thank you.
That was terrific.
Don't forget,
Marty.
Very nice.
When are we actually going on a tour? I've never been to any of those sections. I don't know all of New York except for Manhattan.
Send me several pictures. I would really appreciate that. And then when the virus gets out of the way, we'll meet and walk over the Brooklyn Bridge, okay?
That's a deal.
Yes.
That sounds wonderful.
And then on the Brooklyn side, on the Brooklyn side of the bridge is Grimaldi's Pizza. They have great pizza. On Fulton Street, they have the pizza, right?
Grimaldi's in Hoboken?
No, what is it? Grimaldi's in Hoboken, right. But there's a Grimaldi's at the base of the Brooklyn Bridge on the Brooklyn side. Okay.
Yeah.
So we'll have to go there, all right?
Okay.
Looking forward to your other lectures, Marty.
Yeah,
thank you.
West Side Story.
Everyone stay safe, all right?
Yes.
Thank you, Marty. That was great.
This is recorded
so we can watch it again, too.
We'll see how it goes.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you.